Greetings, viewers. Eric the Car Guy here. And as you can see, I have a special guest today. This is Paul, aka ScannerDanner, from ScannerDanner's channel. How are you?
How are you? Thank you very much.
Also, a fellow Rosedale alumni.
Yeah, and I have my Rosedale shirt.
He has his Rosedale shirt.
I promised my boss if I came up here, I'd wear the Rosedale shirt.
Sporting the Rosedale shirt. Anyway, today I thought we might talk a little bit about ground side and positive side switching. I was reading through your book actually and realized that you dedicated a lot of time and effort into figuring out what was ground side switched and what was positive side switched and how that would be a great basis for electrical diagnosis.
Yeah.
So I thought, I'm really glad you're here today. I thought we might be able to do a video and you could help us better understand that concept.
I think it would be awesome. I appreciate you having me. And one of the things that I think I wrote, you're referring to chapter 3 or section 3.
Yeah.
I have an introduction on that, where I talk about how many different things that we can actually do once we understand the circuitry and how it's controlled. And it really goes beyond the car. You know, it goes to a refrigerator I bought that the ice maker didn't work and had a solenoid that was malfunctioning, and I was able to troubleshoot that ice maker, and I don't know anything about it. I don't have a wiring diagram on it, and I was able to use these same procedures that we're going to go over today, you know, to troubleshoot that solenoid on that ice machine.
So these are just basic electrical procedures that you can use whenever you're diagnosing an electrical problem.
Correct, across the board.
Across the board.
Yep.
So aside from having a wiring diagram, which would be the ideal situation, and being able to trace the circuit and everything, This is a great stepping off point.
Correct, and it's, again, all over the car, you know, injectors and relays and solenoids and light bulbs and motors, and all over the car we can apply these same principles to.
Well, let's go over to the toolbox here and see what we got.
Okay, cool.
We have a 12-volt battery here on the bench, and it's sort of a makeshift apparatus here, sort of hooked up. I have, Paul is not responsible for this. Any of my bad soldering or any of the stuff that you see here, it's just something I made. I'm Eric the Car Guy's responsible, so please leave your comments to Eric the Car Guy. But the reason why we have this here is because we're going to explain the differences between things that are ground side switched and things that are positive side switched. And that is important. Why?
Well, it's important in troubleshooting. I mean, when it comes down to it, that's really why a lot of us are here, and your viewers included. You're trying to figure out what's wrong with your car. You're trying to figure out what's wrong with the circuit, and you want to be able to troubleshoot the circuit. You need to know this as a, I'm going to use your words, as a starting off point or a jumping off point. We need to know circuit design before we can test it.
And what I mean when I say ground side switched or positive side switched is, just for demonstration purposes here, right now the circuit's not hooked up. This is the negative side of the battery, which would be the ground or earth. And if I connect it here like this, I just became a switch on the ground side of the circuit. So when we say ground side switched, the switch, and right now I'm becoming the switch, this is a ground side switched circuit. Now, if it's positive side switched, the end result is the same. It's just we're switching on and off on the positive side as opposed to the negative side. So why is that important as far as diagnosis is concerned?
Well, on the car, most of that's determined by the engineer. In the case of a light bulb, it really doesn't matter much whether you switch the power or ground, the light bulb is going to light. Same thing with a solenoid. A solenoid, we're making a magnetic field, or a relay, we're making a magnetic field. It doesn't really matter. Certain circuits it does. Say a door lock motor, for example, would be reverse polarity, and we need to extend it to unlock it and retract it to lock it. So the engineers will design a circuit that literally switches the positive and negative, so it changes its direction. So sometimes it matters, but for all of the other circuits that I just mentioned where it doesn't really matter, the circuit works the same way, it matters to us when it comes to troubleshooting. If you want to know where you have an open or where you have a short in the circuit, or if you want to know if the circuit is good, we need to know these designs.
So we need to know whether it's switched on the positive side or the negative side. And from there, as I said, a stepping off point to the rest of your diagnosis.
Correct.
So in this video, we're just going to explore how you make the determination between whether or not something is ground side switched or positive side switched.
Exactly.
So how do we do that?
There's a few different ways that we can do this. One of them is with a voltmeter. Another way that it can be done is with a wiring diagram. But, you know, the fact is, a lot of us don't have wiring diagrams available to us, and the circuit's sitting right in front of us. When I'm thinking back to my refrigerator that wasn't working, the ice maker solenoid wasn't filling the ice machine, I did not have a wiring diagram for that. I needed to figure out its circuit design so I could troubleshoot whether or not the solenoid was good or bad. And really, that's what we're doing here. We're going to use a voltmeter to do it.
So how do we use a voltmeter to make that determination?
So anytime we start with a voltmeter, the first thing you want to do is make sure that your meter has a good ground. You know, we hear that a lot. Check your meter, check your meter. Your meter is never an issue. You've been using it for the past 20 years. The issue is you're checking that ground. So when I come over here and check this positive and read 12 volts on my meter, I'm checking that ground. And I see you wiggling that, and you saw that voltage change a little bit there.
Connections are so important with electricity. If you've got any kind of corrosion or this connection isn't solid, all of your testing is going to be off because you're not going to have accurate readings as a result of that bad ground.
And that's key. All of your, what you just said, all of your testing is going to be off. You're losing before you've even begun if you didn't make sure you have a good ground on your meter.
You're starting with less than half a glass of water.
Exactly.
There's nothing left.
Right. All right, so we're starting with a power side. Sorry, we have constant power going to our ball. We're starting with a ground side switch circuit. So we have no ground right now. And what I always tell my students to do is you go to the component and you take two voltage measurements.
All right, so this is our connector.
Correct.
This is ground side switched in that we have the positive hooked up going to the bulb load, whatever you have it, that goes here. And then the negative side is in the open position.
Open.
So in other words, the switch would be off.
Correct.
At this point. So we're just gonna check to see whether this is a positive side switched or a ground side switched using the voltmeter.
Based on our voltage reading. So if you picture this on the car and this is your connector on the car, you have a two pin connector going to whatever.
Right.
Take two voltage measurements would be your first step. And so it really on the car too, we don't know which one's going where. So that's another perspective to have, is I know here we can clearly see that I have a constant power on this. So nobody's going to be surprised when I touch this and I have 12 volts. Go ahead.
I'm not surprised.
Okay.
I was waiting for the surprise, but you just told me not to be.
Well, look, I mean, think about this being on the car. On the car,
right.
We don't know where that's
going. It's in a wiring harness. It's going someplace down underneath the intake manifold, down and away where the mice will chew on the wires somewhere. So, no, we don't know. All we know is what's in our hand.
You got it. So 12 on this one. And the result of this one will really answer my question. I have 12 on that one too, which tells me that this circuit does not have a ground right now. It is ground side switched.
So it has a power supply going to it,
yep.
But it does not have a complete circuit.
Yep, and what a lot of people make the mistake when they do this is they'll take a measurement here and they see 12 volts, and then they take a measurement here and they see another 12, and so they think that there's two 12 volt feeds coming in here. No. And that's not what we have. No. What we have is 12 volts coming in, going through the bulb filament and coming back out, and it's really looking for a ground. It's not really looking for a ground, but that's what I say.
In order for it to happen.
Correct.
In order for anything. Right now, it's just a bunch of potential energy.
That's right.
It's got nowhere to go.
Yep.
So, and we just measured and find out that it has tons of potential energy.
Yep.
Meaning that it's switched on the ground side.
Correct. And from there, too, let's answer another question that I know some people are going to have is, well, wait, doesn't the bulb have a certain amount of resistance, or doesn't the, you know, relay or solenoid or whatever you're measuring, doesn't it have a certain amount of resistance? And
good point.
It does, but if there's no current flow through here, you can't apply the Ohm's law voltage drops unless
nothing's
there's
happening.
Current flow.
Nothing's
so
happening.
No current flow, no voltage drop.
It's just like a battery that's out of the car. Just, it's got 12 volts. It's sitting there. It has 12 volts. But until you hook it up to something, it's not doing anything.
Correct.
So that's what we have here.
That's what we have here. So let's take this one step further. So now we know we have 12 and 12. We know it's ground side switched.
Okay.
The next thing that I like to share with my students would be, which one is the control wire? Which one of these two is the feed, and which one is the ground? And there's a way to do that on the car. It's pretty simple. What we would do is we would disconnect the component. I need to be careful with our little light bulb here.
Sorry.
It's okay. This is why we added this connector here. So we disconnect the component, and then remember, on the car, we were measuring on the harness of the car, so that part's still there, and we retake those measurements again.
So in other words, before we would have been back probing, so to speak.
That's correct, yeah, we should have probably mentioned that.
We should have probably mentioned that. So yeah. The component would have still been connected, and we would have been back probing.
Really important piece that we just totally blew past.
But we're making up for it now. Now we've disconnected the component from the circuit, and now we can basically find out which side is feed and which side is not.
Correct.
By?
taking your voltage measurements again. We have 12 volts on that one, which really answers my question. That wire right there that I read 12 volts on, it's not going to read 12 anymore, which
it's
we
not
know.
Hooked up to anything.
It's not hooked up.
There's not a complete circuit.
That's right.
So
this is the control side of that bulb.
So if we want to know if it's ground side switch, should we leave it plugged in and back probe to start with?
Yes.
And then we can disconnect and we can find out which is the control and which is the switch
that
side.
That is absolutely correct.
Okay, just to summarize here. For the ground side switching. Mm-hmm. When our circuit is hooked up in this way, our component is plugged in and it's ground side switched. When we do the back probing, we basically get 12 volts on both sides of the circuit. So our source voltage, let's say. If we unplug the component and just check the leads themselves, that'll tell us which side is the positive feed and which side should be ground. Maybe we should say that it should be ground because there could be some other issues there.
I like that.
Okay, so which side should be ground? So at this point, we've made the determination, one, that it is something that is ground side switched. Two, we've also made the determination of what is supposed to be positive and what is supposed to be ground in the circuit. So from there, we can jump off and we can get the rest of our diagnosis. Namely, a wiring diagram would be our best friend, that type of thing, and then we could further find out what is supposed to be the switch. The switch in this case is me, but it could be like, say, a module or, mm-hmm. or you know, the computer or some other component could be causing this to switch on and off. So this works with anything. No matter who's switching, it doesn't matter, so long as we have this setup here.
Perfect.
So now, if we want to switch over, well, how about we do this? How about we hook this up and see what our readings are now as far as...
So our feed should be the same. And
or close to it. We got a little bit of a drop.
And
there.
That's because this bulb draws about 2 amps of current,
okay.
Which we
measure. So we're going to see a little bit of a voltage drop. We're not going to cover that here. We'll cover that in another video.
Correct. So our 12-volt feed is the same, and our ground is very, very near zero.
Very, very near zero.
And disconnect that again, and we'll just stay on that one, and we can watch that.
Cool. Okay. So with the switch off or open, battery voltage, with the switch connected, we've got pretty close to zero.
And very simply, we're just providing a ground.
We're providing a ground. So this would be the difference between the two. So off, we'd have our source voltage, and on, we would have a significant drop close to zero is what we would have.
Yep.
So that would be ground side switching.
And if this was a computer controlled circuit, I would call that a control wire.
Okay. All right, so now
we're on the power side.
Let's make this positive side switch. So if we're positive side switched, what would we expect to see in the same situation?
Well, it's completely opposite. So again, leading into this, we leave the component plugged in and we back probe it, carefully I might add. And we don't want to, maybe just a little warning here.
Okay.
We never want to use two T-pins if you're using a T-pin, because if they would touch each other and this was a computer controlled circuit, bad things can happen. One at a time,
total
please.
Short circuit. Yes.
Okay, so we're back probing the circuit plugged in and we just take two voltage measurements again. And we measure this one, we got zero on
zero.
That. And we measure this one.
Still zero.
Mm-hmm.
So we have no source voltage coming into the circuit.
Correct. And another thought would be on this circuit, realizing that, okay, this is showing us power side switching, that one of these wires is constantly grounded. And that would make complete sense for the readings that we have.
So how would we make that determination in the same way we made a determination on the ground side switch?
We have to be a little bit more creative. And what I generally will teach my guys to do now is another really, I know my fancy tools. You guys love my fancy tools.
Oh,
but
yeah.
This one isn't fancy at all. It's just a little $10 test light.
Love it.
And what we can do is, thinking of circuit design and what I just said, one of these two is a constant ground. Take a test light, go to battery positive, and when our test light finds a ground, it is going to light. So, test light's lit, right?
Got it.
One of these two is a ground. Touch this one. Oh, well, a little monkey wrench here that I wasn't even thinking about. Circuit's still plugged in, and so I'm getting
right.
a back feed.
Right. You're getting the opposite of what you got when you did the...
I need this unplugged to do this.
In other words, yeah.
Okay, so we take our test light to battery positive. When we find a ground, the test light lights. You want this unplugged, similar to what we did before. because we don't want to get a back feed.
Right. So what we're doing now is we're making the determination which is ground and which is power in this particular
circuit.
Which
will be a switched power.
Will be switched.
Or our control wire.
Yeah, switch power. On this side, we're positive side switching, so we're control voltage switching.
One of these two has to be a constant ground if it's power side switched. So we're just taking our test light and we're going to figure out which one it is. And it doesn't light on that one. And get my finger out of the way. It does light.
It does light on that one. So the side that it lights up on would be the ground.
Correct.
Because in this instance, you're supplying the source voltage or the power. So you're then you're getting a path to ground when you touch the ground.
Yep.
Whereas on the positive side, you don't get a path to ground because that's the positive side of the circuit, and therefore that means that's the positive. So it's
correct.
It's somewhat opposite. You just employ the use of a different tool in order to make the determination of who's what.
You got it exactly.
Nice.
Just a little simple test light.
So simple test light, voltmeter, we can figure out whether something is positive side switched or ground side switched. Mm-hmm. I like it.
Now let's show this one energized, since we did that in the last one, I guess.
We
have a 0-0 right now.
Right.
And we know that's our ground. We determined that with our test light. So that side's going to stay at 0. And this is the side that's going to switch. So it'll be a little bit different now. And
I can be the third. I'm supposed to be the switch anyway.
Okay. So this would be our switched side. And you want to take that off and back on, and we can kind of watch that. And now what we're doing is what you guys noticed before is when voltage dropped, the light came on. And now when voltage rises, the light is coming on. And so that really just matches the circuit design.
And that's what we're here to figure out.
Yep.
That's fantastic. I could do this all day. Maybe I should be a traffic light. Awesome. Shall we wrap this up?
Perfect. Yeah, I think what we covered is really the foundation of moving on to the next step and figuring out where your wiring problem is. And really not having to rely on someone else's information on how to check the circuit. If you know how the circuit works, then once you have that foundation, then we can plug in all the variables.
Ground side switching, positive side switching, it's an important stepping off point to figure out how the circuit operates so that you can, from there, diagnose the problem. Mm-hmm. So if you know if it's ground side switched, you can go about it in one way. If you know it's positive side switched, you can pursue it a different way. So in this video, we determined how you make the determination of what you have. Is there anything else that you might want to add, like small little things you might want to add that might come up? I know you had a lot because you wrote about this extensively in your book. I think you had 2 chapters on it as far as what it was. It's just kind of why I wanted to touch on it today.
But. Well, there's so many different things and directions we could go, but I know we'll keep it simple. I think one that comes to mind would be if a circuit is on before you start doing your measurements, you're not going to be able to figure out circuit design, because if the circuit is on, you're going to read 12 volts on one wire and 0 volts on the other in both circumstances, whether it be power or ground side switch. So that would be one. And another one would be if there's opens in any of the wiring, that will change your readings too. Picture an open in a ground side switch circuit on the feed wire. It's going to read 0 and 0. You might think it's power side switched, or maybe a power side switch circuit with an open in the ground that reads 12 and 12. And you know, you think the circuit's off, but it's really not, and it's on. And so we could go round and round with that. But those would be 2 that would come to mind right away and throw a variable.
Right. But this is important as far as establishing circuit design in a very basic way, granted. But if it applies to many things, like you spoke about earlier in the intro about your refrigerator. Mm-hmm. It's not something that just works for automotive. It's something that works as far as electricity, because electricity works the same whether it's in a vehicle or something else.
Yeah.
It's still the same principles that are behind it. So you have a switch that turns on a load on and off, that kind of thing, and it could be on the ground or the positive side. And that has an effect on how you would diagnose that circuit. And you would go looking for those things that you mentioned from there.
Yeah, for sure. And you know, I think maybe, like you stated, just to reiterate again, that this is a starting point. You know, this is a platform that we use, and it gives us good direction. And you know, it's not foolproof. It doesn't always show you the right direction, and we back that up with wiring diagrams and other tools. But this is absolutely something that needs to be absorbed and really have a good understanding for to continue.
Awesome. Paul, thank you so much.
Thank you, Eric.
If you have automotive questions, I would ask that you head over to EricTheCarGuy.com. Why? Because it's the coolest place on the planet to get answers to your automotive questions. Mm-hmm. There's a welcome video there to tell you about all those wonderful features we have at EricTheCarGuy.com to help you with those automotive issues, should you have them. If you wish to connect with me socially, I can be found on Google+, Facebook, and Twitter. I will also post a link in the description to the book that I mentioned in this video of Scanner Danner, along with Scanner Danner's channel. You can check that out. And I close each of my videos with what? Be safe. Have fun.
Stay dirty.
Awesome. See you next time.